Afforestation. So we're going to plant a lot of trees. So there we have a moderate, low growth policy for afforestation. That took point one off. Now, one of the things that's interesting here is we should take a look at how much land is needed for that. And you have quite a few sources of carbon dioxide removal because you've also implemented the technological CDR here. So let's take a look here. The bottom one is BECCS. That's bioenergy with carbon capture and sequestration. That means you need land to grow bio crops for biofuel that, that you're then going to capture the CO2 when you burn it. You're going to generate electric power when you burn it, capture the CO2, and then liquefy it, pipe it to somewhere, and bury it where you hope it'll stay sequestered essentially forever. Then the red band above that is biochar. This is where you take bio crops that you're going to have to grow on land that's used for something else today, and then you're going to pyrolyze it, so heat it without oxygen, drive off the volatile gases, use those gases to drive an electric turbine, and then you're left with charcoal, and then you're going to bury the charcoal and hope that it stays in the ground and doesn't get mobilized back into CO2. Above that, we have reductions from agricultural practices. Above that, we have direct air capture. Above that, we have enhanced mineralization. This is where you liquefy carbon dioxide from carbon capture and sequestration operations, and you pump it down into the ground where it might react with, say, basalt and turn into calcium carbonate and lock that CO2 up in the rock. This has been demonstrated theoretically in a couple of pilot projects in Iceland, for example. And then this big blue band, that is the carbon removed by afforestation. And this is interesting. Let's take a quick look at what happens in the base case if we just do afforestation. So let's look and see. This is the afforestation, the reduction in CO2 in billions of tons, gigatons of CO2 per year from planting all those trees, starting today. Why does it take so long? The tree is, the sapling is this big. And then it doubles, but it's still only got a few grams of carbon in it. It isn't until decades later that those trees get big enough that they start to pull a lot of carbon out of the air. Also, you notice it peaks and then starts to fall at the end. Why is that? Those trees die, they get burned. When they die, when the branches fall off or in storms or insect damage or diseases or just the normal life cycle, then that carbon eventually goes back into the atmosphere as bacteria and fungi respire on that wood or the leaf litter in the forest. So it takes a long, long time. So, you know, it's a very good thing to do. When is the best time to plant a tree? 10 or 20 years ago. What's the next best time to plant a tree? Today. So this is a wonderful thing to do, but there's a long time delay. And there's one other consideration that we ought to think about, which is how much land does that take? So if I look at land for carbon dioxide removal, just with afforestation, you need about 400 million hectares of land. Most people have no idea what that really means. The dotted line there is the total land area of India. And in your scenario, where you have all these other sources of carbon dioxide removal, let's see what the land impact would be. It's basically the same, even though you would need additional land for BECCS and biochar that we're not counting here. So implicitly, that's all happening on unused land, which is not likely to happen. But we're getting close. We're at 2 degrees.